The goal of the research was to determine if latent fingerprint examiners can make or would be able to make identifications, exclude properly latent prints, say not readily visible to the naked eye. In this case, we had these 13 volunteers leave over 2,000 prints on different objects that were round, flat, smooth, and we developed them with black powder and tape lifts. We did the ACE part of it, which is analyze, compare, evaluate, where we gave latent examiners, 109 latent examiners, unknown fingerprints or palm prints, latents to look at and compare to three known sources. So essentially compare this latent to one of these 30 fingers or one of these six palms. So as participants were looking at the latent lifts and comparing them to the subjects, we asked them if they could identify any of those three subjects as being the source of that latent print. In that case, they would call that an identification. If we ask them to exclude, we're basically asking them to tell us that none of those three standards made that latent, were not the source of that latent print. That ACE fee, that verification process, where a second latent examiner looks at that comparison and does their own analysis, comparison, and gives their evaluation of that decision. When we found that under normal conditions where one examiner made an identification and a second examiner verified that no erroneous identifications got past that second latent examiner, so it had a false positive rate of zero. So when we're looking at ACE comparisons where one latent examiner looked at a print, one latent examiner analyzed, compared, evaluated, and came up with a decision, we came up with there was a false positive rate, which is basically an erroneous identification where they identified the wrong source. Without verification, there was a 3% error rate for that type of identification. And we also tracked a false negative rate where, given those three standards, people were erroneously excluded as that source, where you're given the source, you say, check one of these three people, and then you now eliminate and said that latent print does not come from one of those three people, even though it did. So that would be a false negative rate. And that false negative rate was 7.5%. What we did during the third part of our phase in this test, we were testing for repeatability, and we were testing for reproducibility. We sent back answers after 6 months. We sent back participants their own answers, and we also gave them answers from other participants, but all those answers came back as if they were verifying somebody's answers. Under normal conditions, we would give them the source, we would give them the latent number, and it's basically agree, disagree, or inconclusive. When the bias conditions, we'd give them the identification answer, somebody identified this, give them the answer of a verifier, so now it's already been verified, and now we want them to give a second verification. Having those prints verified, sending out those erroneous identifications to other latent examiners, not one latent examiner under just regular verification process, not one latent examiner identified that. They caught all those errors. So it actually brought the error rate, the reportable error rate, dropped down to zero. We maintained our regular caseload. This was done in the gaps in between, after hours. The hardest part of doing this was not being dedicated researchers. So that's why it took us quite a long time to get this done. Now that it's finally out here and we're doing things like this, giving presentations this year, we really hope to expand on this research. The results from this study are very fairly consistent with those of other studies.